Hi, my name is John Miller, the Deliberate Engineer. I worked for 30 years at companies like Microsoft, Amazon, and Google, both as a software engineer and managing other software engineers. This video talks about the things that will help you be able to succeed in your first year or two, helps to describe some of the common mistakes people make, and also how you can go about doing a great job and making it easy for you to be recognized as a top performer at the company. Most of us come into our first position at a big tech company with lots of ambition and also a lot of misconceptions. As we enter, we say we want to make a huge splash and do something very impressive that'll just knock everybody's socks off. Well, it turns out this is exactly the wrong thing to do. What you want to do is do the best job you can for the job you've been hired to. In big tech, hiring of new graduates is usually done by a group that's separate from the group they'll actually work in. A manager identifies a need for somebody new. Whoever's been hired who has roughly the appropriate skills and expertise will be assigned to that manager's group. At that point, the manager knows absolutely nothing about the new hire coming in. All they know is that they have some work that needs to get done that was important enough that they were able to get the new hire for their team in the first place. If you're a new hire, think about the job from the manager's perspective. They have a lot of work that needs to get done. The thing that they're most interested in is getting somebody on board who can come up to speed quickly, who'll be able to contribute to the team and help reduce that backlog of work that they're just waiting to get done. Having somebody who comes in with a lot of new ideas and initiates different strange projects that aren't related to the team's primary mission is actually going to be a problem for the team rather than a benefit. So how do you get up to speed and start being productive within a new team? First and foremost, they usually have onboarding training. So you want to take whatever onboarding training there is so that you know the standards and the requirements for the position. Make sure that you have a mentor who can help show you the ropes and answer any questions that come up to you. Learn the coding tools and the other infrastructure that's required for you to do the job. Get familiar with the code base and understand the design of things. And finally, make sure that you're proactive and that you always are pushing forward and delivering great results. When you join a new team, you'll typically get some sort of a new hire or an onboarding document that describes various places you can get information and gives you pointers to the places that you should look when you have a question. Also, there will typically be some sort of an in-person training. Take the onboarding and the new hire training very seriously. Make sure you go to all of it, take notes as you need to, and internalize the information. Any pointers that they have, make sure that you make a note of those so that you'll be able to follow up on them later. The onboarding process is really an investment in your future at the company. If you don't pay attention, if you wind up asking questions that could have been answered by the onboarding, that's going to be trouble for you. It'll wind up making you less efficient and slower and could result in you doing all the wrong things. So absolutely take the onboarding process seriously and do the best job you can at it. It's well worth the investment. A mentor is incredibly important to succeed when you join a new team. Ideally, it'll be somebody who's fairly familiar with the project already, but not somebody who's got a whole lot of experience. Somebody who was just onboarded themselves recently will be familiar with the current process, whereas somebody with more experience might have an outdated notion of what needs to be done, not remember the answers to the questions off the top of their head, and worse, they might point you the wrong direction. And of course, you don't want to have somebody who's super senior as your mentor either, because that person can wind up not having any time, be spread too thin, and again, have very little understanding of the things that are important to being able to start up in the group. Ideally, you want your mentor to be a single person rather than a group of people. For example, if the boss says, well, just ask anybody in the group a question, you should identify one person that you want to be working with. If you're working with a single person, they know that they're your safety net. They'll take you more seriously when you have questions. They'll follow up with you and make sure that things look good. If you have a whole group of people as your mentor instead, then it's very easy to fall through the cracks as everybody assumes somebody else is taking care of whatever problems that you have and that they don't have to check up on you and see how things are going. Make sure that you book a formal weekly meeting with your mentor. Don't just rely on your daily sync-ups to cover everything that needs to be covered. There's going to be issues that just won't seem that relevant for an ad hoc meeting, but that you will think to bring up in a one-to-one formal meeting. For example, especially information about your career or how you're doing in the company. So make sure you have a regularly scheduled meeting with your mentor in addition to meeting with them ad hoc whenever you have questions. One thing that doesn't occur to lots of new employees is that standards, processes, and tools are really the lifeblood of being able to get work done in a company. You should spend time getting up to speed and being able to be productive with the tools and the processes ranging from bug tracking to issues, information for Scrum if they do some sort of agile work, and make sure that you really understand how to use them. You shouldn't go overboard with this. You don't want to know everything there is to know about it, because that means you're not producing any results. Instead, reach some sort of compromise where you learn the basics of the tools, you start delivering things, and then you continue improving your knowledge of the tools as you continue to deliver. The most important tools for you to know as a new hire are the internal search and documentation sites. For example, a wiki and maybe an internal search engine for both documentation for your team and for the source code that your team uses. You also want to be familiar with the tools for defect tracking and for work items and Scrum. Make sure that you understand the editing and the code production environment that most of the people in the team use. You may have your own preferences from wherever you were earlier, but the fact is it's very beneficial if you use the same tools and the same processes as most of the other people on the team, and especially as your mentor. This helps make sure that when you ask for help and you have questions, it's a familiar environment to them, for them to be able to give you advice and to give you guidance. Absolutely worth learning the tools that are used within the group. Also, you should make sure that you understand the code review tools and the code review process. One cautionary note about internal documentation: it tends to be a two-edged sword. On the one hand, it gives information that you just won't find anywhere else. People talk about the source code being the documentation, but it's really not. Lots of times the source code is naked and it has bugs in it. But if you find the documentation and answer some of your questions, it may be incomplete, it may be stale, it may be out of date, and this in turn can lead to you thinking the wrong things about the code. So you need to have a compromise between looking at the documentation, looking at the code, and talking to people who have worked more recently in the code that you're interested in. For example, by taking a look and seeing who's checked into the source recently so that you can ask some questions about that code base. Another key part of being an effective developer in a company is understanding the source control process, how to make a copy of the source code, how to make a branch that you can do your own work in, and then how to take the results that you create in that branch and merge them back into the primary code base. Now, if this sounds like gobbledygook to you, you'd better prioritize learning about source control tools such as Git. Git is probably the most common source control tool right now, and it's one that you can learn about before you ever get started at your job. I mentioned this earlier, but the last set of tools that you should probably get familiar with are the code review tools. In other words, how to create a code review once you've got a change ready for review by other people, and the coding guidelines that you're required to follow for it. Sometimes these coding guidelines are voluntarily done. Sometimes they're strictly enforced by the check-in tools. Whatever the case, you're likely to get an awful lot of feedback in your code reviews about complying to the standards that have been set for the team. Make sure that you know how to ask for a review of your code using the tool. Also, make sure that you know how to update your code to address any issues that are raised in the code review tool, and then how to have those changes reflected in the tool so that people can sign off on them. This is a primary part of getting your work done as a developer, and something everybody who's checking in code should know how to do. Don't be discouraged if you have lots of comments on your code. This is something very common for everybody, including senior developers when they first join a new team. The coding standards and the things that are important to code bases tend to vary from company to company. Those are the core technologies that you should be aware of as you enter your first year in a big tech company. In addition to those, I'd like to give you a few snippets of advice that I've found to be useful over the years for people who are just getting started. Be proactive. In other words, don't let yourself get blocked by things when you need information or you need somebody to do something. Your answer when somebody asks, "What's the status of this project?" should never be, "Oh, I sent mail a few days ago and I'm still waiting for them to answer me." Instead, you should be following up and doing whatever you can to unblock yourself. You need to be understood to be somebody who's proactive and who will take care of making sure the job gets done, even when there's hurdles in the way that have to be overcome. Now, in some cases, you won't be able to unblock yourself. In that case, you should go to your mentor or maybe to your manager, talk to them and say, "Hey, I have this problem that I'm trying to work around. So far, it's blocking me. I'm not quite sure what to do next. What should I do to resolve this problem?" In some cases, the manager or the mentor will actually take over that issue and get it unblocked, but they will appreciate the fact that you said that you wanted to own it and take care of moving it forward. Something I mentioned earlier, don't succumb to the temptation to work outside of your assigned area, at least for the first 6 months. If you find that you're completing your tasks early, ahead of the deadlines, then the right thing to do is to go back to your mentor or your manager, or take a look at the list of work items and see if you can pick up other related work that gets your component even further ahead of schedule. If you do have some great ideas for things that you'd like to get done, it's fine to bring those up with your mentor or your manager, but don't go and do those independently unless you've absolutely nailed everything that could possibly be done for your component. You've been hired to help the team meet its objectives. Even if you do something really awesome, chances are they won't appreciate it if it came at the cost of getting further ahead in the components that you're supposed to be working on. Learn the nomenclature. Terminology is a little different for every team and every company, and oftentimes they will have their own acronyms or their own words for things that may be common with other places. They can even have words for things that mean something else at other places. So as you hear conversations or in your meetings or you're reading things and you see terms you're not familiar with, just go ahead and make a note of those for later. Then you want to use the search tools you've already learned how to use for your job and use those to look up the acronyms. If you absolutely can't find the meaning of some of the terms, go and talk to your mentor. Sometimes even the mentor won't know what it means, and that's a case where it's probably worth digging a little further and you'll get some appreciation from other members of the team for really explaining what it means. Be helpful to others. Be generous with your time as long as it's not going to cause problems with the things that you have to deliver. This will help you build up goodwill and have people be more willing to help you in the future. And plus, it's just part of being a decent human being. Integrate into the team. If people get together for coffee or for lunches, or if they occasionally get together and do something else, try and participate in that. You'll make some great new friends, and it will help you bond with the team, and overall, it'll help everybody have a better time. This is, again, something that can just wind up really paying dividends for you. And for me, at least, some of the best friends that I ever made were people who I was working with. So it might be the place where you meet your new best friends. When you're given a chance to present something or explain something, jump on that chance. Don't pass on it because it feels a little uncomfortable. This is a critical skill for you to be able to grow into a senior engineer and be able to succeed at companies in general. I remember when I first started working at Microsoft, I was so shy that even when I was asked a direct question in a meeting, I didn't like to answer it. And I actually talked to my manager after the first meeting where he asked me something. He said, "Can you tell me before the meeting next time so that I know and I have an answer prepared?" So fast forward 30 years, and these days I'm pretty comfortable talking off the cuff to pretty much anybody about pretty much anything technical. It's not something that happened just by itself. It took a lot of practice and it took a lot of opportunities to present things. It's good to start that as early as possible. It can be a real differentiator for you being able to move up quickly in the company. There's 100 more tips I could give you, but I think that's probably enough for one day. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos like it, please consider subscribing. Also, if you found the video useful, give it a thumbs up or a like. That really helps me to understand the sort of content that people are interested in seeing in the future. Thanks again for watching this far, and keep on pushing forward.